Hi guys, this is Vaish from Vaish IAS, and we are going to continue the R.S. Sharma series. We are on chapter 15 now. Totally, this textbook has a chapter, I think chapter number 27, that is the last chapter, okay. So we have to complete all these things. Maybe in 1 or 2 days it will be completed. So spectrum is already there, so modern history is done, and this is ancient history, and next I'll be going for medieval history, hopefully, okay. So please watch all these videos just like you watched the spectrum series. And also, I know many people approached me for modern history MCQs after that. Same way, ancient history, medieval history, everything we have MCQs. So I would suggest you not to buy subject wise, instead get the whole package, okay. So that, because UPSC is nearing, prelims is nearing, we have to practice all the subjects, okay, not only history. So history, geography, science and tech, whatever, anything and everything which is needed for UPSC prelims, I am covering it. So just buy the test series. The description box will have the link of the particular video where I launched the test series of Vaish IAS, okay. So please watch that video. Now we'll continue chapter 15, okay. So as usual, from the actual PDF, that is R.S. Sharma PDF, we are going to do the classes. So the chapter name is Central Asian Contacts and Their Result, okay. This is a very, very important chapter with respect to prelims, because a lot of dynasty names are there, a lot of people names are there, and it is a little bit confusing. The chronology, if they ask, UPSC if they ask, it is very confusing. So that is why our test series anyway will cover from each and every page of this textbook. Also I have covered MCQs, okay. So try to get that. So we'll start this particular paragraph. The period which began in about 200 BC did not witness a large empire like that of the Mauryas, okay. So we have done till Mauryas till now. So now we are going to talk about the age after that, okay, the post Mauryan age. So but it is notable for intimate and widespread contacts between Central Asia and India. In Eastern India, Central India and the Deccan, the Mauryans were succeeded by a number of native rulers such as the Sungas, Kanvas and Satavahanas. Okay, so these are three important dynasties you should know. The timeline, if somebody asks you suddenly, you should immediately able to recollect that these are the post-Mauryan people. Okay, that too, not near the Ganga basin, but you can tell western side or the Deccan side and all. Okay, in Eastern India also it's there, but not exactly near the Deccan basin. The Gangatic basin. And then Sungas, last chapter also I told you, Pushyamitra Sunga, a Brahmin, he was not happy with the Buddhism and all those things which Ashoka was doing. That is why he came up to power and Sunga dynasty was established. Okay, so Sungas, Kanvas and Satavahanas. Satavahanas, there is a separate chapter also. We'll do that separately. So let's continue. The Indo-Greeks, okay, these were actually the first people who came into India from outside. So this chapter will be dealing with all these people who came from outside. A series of invasions took place from about 200 BC. The first to cross the Hindu Kush. Hindu Kush is in Afghanistan, okay, Hindu Kush range. You should know the geography also. Hindu Kush were the Greeks who ruled Bactria. So Bactria, whenever we refer to this term, you should immediately understand it is referring to the Greeks, okay, lying south of the Oxus River in the area covered by North Afghanistan. So in the North Afghanistan region, the Hindu Kush region, there were people called Bactria, or the place called Bactria, where Greeks ruled. So they came through the Hindu Kush and came inside India. The invaders came one after the other, but some of them ruled at one and the same time on parallel lines. Okay, so they're telling like it's not like one came and went back, then second came, went back. It's not like that. Almost everyone were ruling parallelly. Okay. So one important cause of invasions was the weakness of the Seleucid Empire, which has been established in Bactria and the adjoining areas of Iran called Parthia. Okay, so Iran, this Parthia, whenever you hear, you should immediately remember Iran. Okay, Parthia is Iran and Bactria is Greek in Afghanistan region. Okay, such things you should be able to relate. On account of growing pressure from Scythia tribes, the later Greek rulers were unable to hold their power in this area. With the construction of the Chinese wall, the Scythians were now not in a position to push forward into China. So if you remember the decline of Mauryans I taught you last chapter, Chinese rulers were building the Great Wall of China to protect them from all the external tribes, but Ashoka did not do anything in India. So that is why Mauryan rule came to an end. Okay, so that they are telling again, Scythians could not approach the Chinese now. So they turned their attention towards the neighboring Greeks and Parthians. Okay, Parthians is the Iran region and Greeks is the Afghan region. So pushed by the Scythian tribes, the Bactrian Greeks were forced to invade India. Okay, so it was the situation demanded. They had to come towards India. The successes of Ashoka were too weak to stem the tide of foreign invasion. Okay, so here some coins are also mentioned. And the first to invade India were the Greeks, I already told you, who were called the Indo-Greeks or the Bactrian. Okay, so these are some coins. Details we'll see. Map is also there, so maybe you can pause it and watch it. The Bactria region, the Parthia region, all they are showing. Capisa is there, okay. So these are all different names which you should know where it is. In the beginning of the 2nd century BC, the Indo-Greeks occupied a large part of northwestern India, much larger than that conquered by Alexander. So Alexander, you know, huge empire he had, but still these Indo-Greeks had even more larger thing. So that statement you should know. If UPSC asks it, you should know Indo-Greeks had even more area than Alexander's region. Okay, they said that they pushed forward as far as Ayodhya. Okay, Ayodhya, you know, in UP. So Ayodhya and Patliputra, that is Patna in Bihar. So up to that they had their range. So it will be very, very huge, right? right from the westernmost region till the Pataliputra in the east. So, but the Greeks failed to establish united rule in India. So that is why they failed. Okay, they did not have any unity, because this much huge place they have to maintain. They should have some holistic leader, right? But it was not having unity. Two Greek dynasties ruled northwestern India on parallel lines at one end and at the same time. The most famous Indo-Greek ruler was Menander. Okay, this is very important. UPSC have asked at least 5 times about this person. So Menander, he is also known as Milinda. Okay, same person. Menander and Milinda, same person. See the timeline also, 165 BC. He had his capital at Sakala, modern Sialkot in Punjab. Okay, in Punjab there is a place modern day. So that Sakala is the place where they had this capital. Okay, Menander or Milinda. And he invaded the Ganga Yamuna Doab. He was converted to Buddhism by Nagasena. Again, a very important person. He is actually a Mahayana related person. Okay, Nagasena is same as Nagarjuna. Again, don't confuse. It's not two separate person. It is same person. So Nagasena, Nagarjuna, same person, had an interaction with Menander Milinda. That's also same person. Okay, and they were like asking question and answer to each other or something, and that related to Buddhism. Okay, they had this conversation, and that is recorded in a book called Milinda Panho or the questions of Milinda. This has been asked multiple times, that is why I am stressing on it. So just don't confuse, like these are separate person. Nagasena Nagarjuna, same person, and Menander Milinda, same person, had a conversation, and the book name is Milinda Panno, the questions of Milinda. Okay, now the Indo-Bactrian rule is important. Okay, Indo-Bactrian rule is important in the history of India because of the large number of coins which the Greeks issued. Okay, so the Indo, now this is again important fact, the Indo-Greeks were the first rulers in India to issue coins. Okay, which can be definitely attributed to the kings. It's not like coins are not there in India, but the coins which has definite king names. Okay, because even during the time of Mauryas and all, they had lot of coins, panchmark coins, everything was there, but it had animal figures or godly figures, but attributed to the king. Okay, like the king photo or something will be there. Like in Gupta time, you will see Samudragupta had the Samudragupta playing the veena, one coin is there. Okay, so such things are there later in Gupta phase, but this is the person who started, or the dynasty which started, the Indo-Greeks or the Bactrian rulers were the starting point, okay, of issuing coins attributed to the king. This is not possible in the early Panchmark, whatever I told you, again they are telling. The Indo-Greeks were the first to issue gold coins also. Okay, so coins also, and first to issue gold coins also. Coins for coins attributed to king and gold coins. And it later in under the Kushanas, you will learn separate chapters there. Kushanas, lot of coins were increased. Okay, the Greek rule is also memorable on account of the introduction of Hellenistic art features. Okay, Gandhara art, we learned in art and culture, Gandhara art, Mathura art and all. So the Gandhara art in the Gandhara region, that is the Pakistan region present day, that was introduced by the Greek rule. Okay, so these are very important statements which UPSC can form regarding Indo-Greek or the Bactrian incoming into India. Okay, now the Sakas, the next one. The Greeks were followed by the Sakas, who controlled a much larger part of India than the Greeks did. Okay, so again, this is again much larger part. So it's like Alexander had some area, then Indo-Greek had much larger area, now Sakas has even much larger area. Okay, so there were 5 branches of the Sakas with their seats of power in different parts of India and Afghanistan. Okay, here this is actually one copper plate inscription. Okay, copper plate inscription of about 1st century AD from Kalawan, that is near Taxila, that is again present day Pakistan. It is actually in Karoshti. Karoshti means it will be written from right to left. Okay, like Arabic language. And the language is Prakrit. So the language is Prakrit and the script is Karoshti. Okay, the Nagari rendering and English translation of the first two lines are given below. Not very important, some description is given, but you should know, like Prakrit language was there, Karoshti script was there, copper inscriptions in that place. Okay, Taxila. Sakas settled in Afghanistan. Okay, so they are also outside India and they will be coming inside. Now another branch of the Sakas settled in Punjab and Taxila as their capital. Okay, a third branch settled in Mathura, where they ruled for about 2 centuries. A fourth branch established its hold over western India, where they continued to rule till the 4th century AD. Okay, so from BC times to the 4th century AD, they ruled. A fifth branch of the Sakas established its power in the upper Deccan. So now you don't have to by heart which branch is where, but you should know they had almost the span in the western side of India, the Deccan side, and the little bit to the east, okay, up to Mathura and all they had. So this whole thing you should know, 5 branches, and they had a huge territorial expansion, territorial region under their control. The Sakas did not meet much effective resistance from the rulers and people of India. Okay, so they did not have much opposition. In about 58 BC, we hear of a king of Ujjain who effectively fought against the Sakas and succeeded in driving them out of his time, out of this India. Okay, he called himself the Vikramaditya, and the era was called the Vikram Samvat. Okay, 58 BC. This is very important because later we learned the Saka era also. This is actually the Vikram era. Okay, Vikram Samvat it is called. 58 BC is the timeline. It is like Vikramaditya is a title of one person who actually drove these people out of India. Okay, we don't know how much it is true, but that is mentioned here. So Vikram Samvat, 58 BC, Vikramaditya, and this Vikramaditya title is like later many kings will adopt. Okay, about 14 Vikramadityas are there. It's mentioned here. About 14 Vikramadityas are there in Indian history. It's not like their name is Vikramaditya. Whenever they win some great thing, they will adopt that title. Okay, like Roman Empire emperors were taking the title of Caesar. Okay, Caesar is also not a name, it's a title. So same way in India it was Vikramaditya. Okay, most fashionable name of that time. Up till 12th century AD. Okay, so from the BC times till 12th century AD, we have this kind of namings. Okay, title. Although the Sakas established their rule in different parts of the country, only those who ruled in Western India held power for any considerable length of time, for about 4 centuries or so. The most famous Saka ruler, now next few lines will be about Rudradaman. Okay, Rudradaman is a Saka ruler, that is, he is a foreigner. The name might sound Indian, but he is a foreigner. Okay, and he will come into India and he ruled not only over Sindh, Kutch and Gujarat, but had also recovered from the Satavahanas, Konkan. Okay, Satavahana is again the Deccan region. We'll learn in the next chapter. Okay, the Konkan region, the Narmada Valley, the Malwa, the Kathiawar. So entire western side and Deccan side, this person has under him. Okay, Rudradaman. Okay, then he is famous in history because of the repair works he undertook to improve the Sudarshana Lake in the semi-arid zone of Kathiawar. So you should know something like there is Sudarshana Lake. Okay, there are many things like this, Sudarshana Lake or Saraswati River, Sarayu River. These are all ancient rivers and lakes. Okay, you should know this, which is where. So now Sudarshana Lake is there in the semi-arid region of Kathiawar. So repair works had been done by this particular person, Rudramadaman. So if you ask which ruler he is Saka ruler. Okay, in the 1st century AD, this lake also had been used for irrigation, and then even during time of Mauryans it was used. Okay, but it had to be repaired. Now again, another thing, he is a great lover of Sanskrit, and he is actually the first foreigner or something who issued the longest inscription in Sanskrit. Okay, because till then everything was in Pali, Prakrit and all, and the first longest Sanskrit inscription was by Rudramadaman. So Rudradaman, okay, not Rudramadaman, Rudradaman. Let me check the name one more time. Okay, Rudradaman. Okay, there is Rudrama Devi in Kakatiya dynasty in the south. That is why I got confused. There is another name. So this is Rudradaman, and that is Rudrama Devi of Kakatiya dynasty, Warangal. Okay, so you should know those things. So this is about Greeks. Okay, we learnt a lot about Greeks and Sakas. Now after that, next will be Parthians. The Saka domination in northwest India was followed by that of the Parthians. Parthians, I told you, near the Iran region. And in many ancient Indian Sanskrit textbook, the two people are together mentioned as Saka Pahlavas. Okay, Saka Pahlavas. So this Pahlavas is actually relating to Parthians only in the Sanskrit textbook. In fact, they ruled over this country on parallel lines for some time. Originally, the Parthians lived in Iran, from where they moved to India. Okay, in comparison with the Greeks and the Sakas, they occupied only a small portion of northwestern India in the 1st century. The most famous Parthian king was Gondopharnes. Okay, Gondopharnes, in whose reign St. Thomas is said to have come to India for the propagation of Christianity. In course of time, the Parthians, like the Sakas before them, began an integral part of Indian polity and society. Okay, just like I told you, we have to learn little bit unique features about each of these things. Okay, so Indo-Greece we learned like the coins issue and all those things, Gandhara art, and Sakas we learned Rudradaman and all those contributions by him, the five branches and lot of things. Parthians now it is like from Iran, and then also this king name, okay, Gondopharnes, and also the St. Thomas came to India and spread Christianity. So such like one or two points about each thing and the order, if you know, that is more than enough. Okay, that is what you need to remember for prelims. So next is the Kushanas. The Parthians were followed by the Kushanas. So try to make some keyword like Greek was there, then Sakas, GS, and then PK. Okay, GSPK, something like that you can make. Okay, Greek, Sakas, Parthians and Kushanas. The Parthians were followed by the Kushanas, who were called the Yechis or Tocharians. Okay, these are like tribe names. The Kushans were one of the five clans into which the Yechi tribe was divided. So there was one tribe, there are five branches, five clans, and one of them is the Kushanas. Nomadic people from the steppes of North Central Asia. So now this is a different region, right? Steppes of Central Asia. From there they are coming. Okay, neighborhood of China. The Kushan first occupied Bactria, that is near Afghanistan, where they displaced the Shakas. Okay, gradually they moved to the Kabul Valley and seized Gandhara by crossing the Hindu Kush, replacing the rule of Greeks and Parthians in these areas. Okay, so Greeks and Parthians in there, everyone is replaced and Kushanas are coming in. Finally, they set up their authority over the lower Indus basin and the greater part of Gangetic basin. Their empire extended from the Oxus again in Afghanistan. Okay, Oxus region to the Ganga, from Khorasan in Central Asia to Varanasi in Uttar Pradesh. This is span. Okay, how much they had. A good part of Central Asia now included in the USSR, a portion of Iran, a portion of Afghanistan, and almost all of Pakistan. So it's a very huge thing. Okay, up to Central Asia it is there. That means Kushanas had the greatest empire. Okay, and almost the whole of North India were brought under one rule by the Kushanas. This created a unique opportunity for the commingling of people and cultures. So that is how lot of cultures interacted with each other. Okay, Central Asia, West Asia, India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, everywhere. And the process gave rise to a new type of culture which embarked five modern countries. We come across two successive dynasties of the Kushans. Okay, so Kushan inside itself, they had like internal split, we can tell, like the, up to this timeline it is this thing, and after that something else. So first they are telling about the chief, house of chief, which is like called the Kadphises. That is like, it's like Kadphises 1, Kadphises 2, like that. Or Kadphises, I don't know how they pronounce. So Kadphises 1, Kadphises 2, like that they had different chief. Okay, so those first and second, they are telling some description about. The first one is like who issued coins south of the Hindu Kush. Okay, the first who issued coins south of the Hindu Kush. He minted coppers in imitation of Roman coins. The second king was Kadphises 2, who issued the large number of gold coin, gold money, and spread his kingdom east of the Indus. Okay, so last time also we saw coins were issued, but the large numbers were there in the Kushana time. Later in Gupta time, it will be even more. Okay, the number of gold coins. And this was like imitations of Roman coins, that the copper or gold, they will imitate whatever Romans were doing. Now the house of Kadphises was succeeded by that of Kanishka. Okay, so now Kadphises 1 and Kadphises 2 is over. Now Kanishka's time, lot of like, it's like the huge, it has a huge empire, and also the gold content in the coins will be more. Okay, somewhere it will be mentioned here. Okay, higher gold content than it was formed. Okay, even in higher than the Gupta, which will come later. So although the gold coins of the Kushans were found mainly west of the Indus, their inscriptions are distributed not only in northwestern India and Sindh, but also in Mathura, Shravasti, Kausambi and Varanasi. Hence they had set up their authority in the greater part of the Gangetic Basin. Kushan coins, inscriptions, sculptures and structures found in Mathura shows that it was their second capital in India. Okay, so like this, they had regions, okay, whether it's near Gandhara or whether it's in Mathura, they had capital cities and they had huge towns here and there under their control. Okay, Peshawar is actually their first capital. Okay, Peshawar, or that time it is called Purushapura. Okay, Purushapura, Peshawar is the first capital and Mathura is their second capital. And a huge stupa is there, relic tower, which excited the wonder of foreign travelers. Okay, so people used to come and visit this huge stupa under Kanishka's rule. The most famous Kushan ruler was Kanishka. Although outside the borders of India, he seems to have suffered defeat at the hands of the Chinese. He is known to history because of the two reasons. First, he started an era. Okay, now this is the next one, Saka era, which I told. So even though it's the ruler is Kushana, the era is called Saka era. Okay, Saka era was started by Kanishka of Kushana, that is AD 78. The other one was AD 54, that is Vikram Samvat. Okay, Vikram era, that is because of Vikramaditya driving away Saka out of the country. So you should know this. And if you basically put a statement like Kanishka never was defeated in any battle, that is a wrong statement, because he was defeated by Chinese, okay, outside India. But inside India, he used to win everything, I guess. Now, also another thing is the Buddhist council. The fourth Buddhist council will be held under his patronage only. You have to learn all the councils. In Art and Culture video, I'll do it. Four councils were there, and the name you can remember like AKAK. Okay. The first one was by Ajatasatru. Second one was by Kal Ashoka. Third one is by again Ashoka. And fourth one is by Kanishka. So AKAK. That's how you will remember the names of the people who organized it. Okay. The presiding person is different. That is a different table I have. I'll publish the chart someday. So you should know such things. Okay, now successes of also here great pattern of art and Sanskrit. Okay, that also you should know. Successes of Kanishka continued to rule in northwestern India till about AD 230, and some of them bore typical Indian names such as Vasudeva. So if you see these people, initial names are Kadphises 2, like this, all foreign kind of titles and names. Then Kanishka, then after that it's like Vasudeva. So the name is getting Indianized. Okay, when the hierarchy is coming, the new generation is coming, the name is Indianized. The Kushan Empire in Afghanistan and the areas west of the Indus was supplanted in the mid 3rd century AD by the Sasanian power, which rose in the Iran. Okay, so new kingdom is coming, and then that is how they lost relevance, Kushans. Okay, so but Kushan principalities continued to exist in India for about a century. The Kushan authority seems to have lingered in the Kabul Valley capital. Again, telling a lot of regions, whatever we saw in that map. Okay, so 3-4 centuries they were in power. It's not important, you don't have to buy out all these things. Administrative archives, they had inscriptions, documents, everything written in Aramic script and Khwarezmian language. Okay, some language is there, Khwarezmian. If you Khwarezmian, okay, if you see this, you should understand like Kushans inscriptions were there in this thing. Okay, impact of these Central Asian contacts. We saw 4-5 kingdoms, so we should know the impact. So structures and pottery. The Saka Kushana phase registered a distinct advance in building activities. Excavations have revealed several layers of structures, sometimes more than half a dozen, at various sites in North India. In them, we find the use of burnt bricks for flooring and that of tiles for both flooring and roofing. But the use of surki and tiles may not have been adopted from outside. The period is also marked by the construction of brick wells. Its typical pottery is redware, both plain and polished, with medium to fine fabric. Okay, so it's telling about the construction or the buildings and all the tiles, the flooring, everything. Okay, and they're telling it's not like it's all adopted from outside. Some things were already here, but it was happening. Okay, all these constructions were happening in the Kushan age. The distinctive pots are sprinklers and spouted channels. They remind us of red pottery with thin fabric found in same period in Kushan layers in Soviet Central Asia. So whatever is there in Central Asia, there was some similarity what is there in the Indian region also that time. Red pottery techniques were widely known in Central Asia, and they are found even in regions like Farghana, which were on the peripheries of the Kushan cultural zone. So Farghana Valley near Central Asia, you can tell Afghanistan, North Afghanistan all. So there and here, it's like kind of similarity in pottery, crafts and construction. Now trade and technology. The Sarkars and Kushanas added new ingredients to Indian culture and enriched it immensely. They settled in India for good and completely identified themselves within its culture. So like the name also you saw, like Rudradaman, Vasudev. So they are like becoming Indianized. They are living here and becoming like Indians. Since they did not have their script, language or religion, they adopted these elements of culture from India. Okay, so they did not bring their own script and all. If you remember, Rudradaman wrote a long Sanskrit thing, and also Sanskrit is an Indian language. So they are like using everything what is here. They became an integral part of Indian society, to which they contributed considerably. They introduced better cavalry and the use of riding horse on a large scale. Okay, so this also is an important point. Riding horse on a large scale, they introduced. They made common the use of reins and saddles, which appear in the Buddhist cultures of the 2nd and 3rd century AD. The Sarkars and the Kushans were excellent horsemen. Okay, their passionate love for horsemanship is attested by numerous equestrian terracotta figurines. So a lot of terracotta figurines are there, okay, related to horse and whatever horsemen what they promoted. Some of these foreign horsemen was heavily armored and fought with spears and lances. Possibly they also use some kind of toe stirrup made up of ropes. So it's a little bit detailing of the horse related thing, okay, saddles and whatever they used. The Sarkars and Kushanas introduced turban. Okay, this is important. The Sarkars and Kushanas introduced turban, tunic or something not required, trousers and heavy long coat. Okay. The present day Sherwani is there, right? Sherwani, turbans, all these things came from the Afghan regions only, the western region. So these people were the one who promoted it too much. The Central Asians also brought in cap, helmet and boots, which were used by warriors. Because of these advantages, they made a clean sweep of their opponents in Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan and India. Later, when this military technology spread in the country, the dependent princes turned them to good use against the former conquerors. So they are like introducing lot of these kind of things, armory, horses, jackets, spears, swords, everything. So it's like more modern warfare, right? So that is why they had an advantage over other competitors who were there, the Sarkars and Kushanas. Okay, the coming of the foreigners established intimate contacts between Central Asia and India. As a result, India received a good idol of gold from the Altai Mountains in Central Asia. Gold also have been recovered in India through trade with Roman Empire. The Kushanas controlled the Silk Route, which started from China. This is a UPC statement actually. Okay, Kushanas controlled the Silk Route. Okay, so it was the Kushanas. He controlled the, because if you know, it's like Central Asia is there, Kashmir is there, every place is there. So obviously they'll have this regions, right? So that is how it is telling. They control the Silk Route, which started from China and passed through the empire in Central Asia and Afghanistan to Iran. This route was a source of great income to the Kushans, and they built a large prosperous empire because of the tolls levied from the traders. It is significant that the Kushans were the first rulers in India to issue gold coins on a wide scale. So that is also one important point. One second. Next is the polity. So polity, the Central Asian conquerors imposed their rule on numerous petty native princes. This led to the development of a feudatory organization. The Kushans adopted the pompous title of King of Kings, which indicated their supremacy over numerous small princes. So these Kushana kings, they took the title of King of Kings. That is, they wanted to be supreme over all the other small princes which were already existing there. The Sarkars and the Kushanas strengthened the idea of the divine origin of kingship. The Kushana kings were called sons of God. This title was adopted by the Kushans from the Chinese, who called their king the son of heaven. So in China it was like son of heaven, okay, the king, and here it's like the son of God. So they were all copying things from the Chinese this thing, okay, because they had this extent up till the Chinese neighborhood. They were following things which are happening there. The Hindu lawgiver Manu asked the people to respect the king even if he's a child, because he's a great god ruling in the form of a human being. Okay, this is what Hindu lawgiver Manu is telling. Okay, they also introduced the satrap system. Okay, that is like a province system where like different provinces will be there and different provinces will have different governors. This empire was divided into numerous satrapis, and each satrapi was placed under the rule of a satrap. Some curious practices such as hereditary dual rule, two kings ruling in the same kingdom at one and the same time, were introduced. Okay, so dual rule is also there in some places. So we find that father and son ruled jointly at one and the same time. Okay, so such things used to happen in the Kushana dynasty. You should know, because UPSC will pick these kind of strange, weird statements only and confuse the students. Okay, and this actually is a pillar. Okay, pillar of Heliodorus. Okay, Heliodorus is a Greek person. We'll see, read about him in the coming paragraph. So just remember, there is a pillar at Vidisha, near Vidisha. Okay, Vidisha is actually a place in Madhya Pradesh. So there is a pillar. UPSC is asking pictures related questions also, so you should know. So thus it appears that there was less of centralization under these rulers. Okay, less of centralization because there is dual rule and there is a lot of people ruling together and all. The foreigners also introduced the practice of military governorship. Okay, this was done by the Greeks, who appointed the governors called strategos. So you should know, this is a very important term. Strategos means it's like governors who are appointed by the Greeks. Military governors were necessary to maintain the power of foreign rulers over the conquered people. Now, what are the new elements in Indian society? The Greeks, Shakas, Parthians and Kushanas. Okay, GSPK, you should know that order. GSPK ultimately lost their identity in India. They became completely Indianized in course of time. Since most of them came as conquerors, they were absorbed in Indian society as a warrior class, that is the Kshatriya class. Their placement in the Brahminical society was explained in a curious way. The lawgiver Manu stated that the Shakas and the Parthians were the Kshatriyas who had fallen from their duties. In other words, they came to be considered as second class Kshatriyas. Okay, in no other period of ancient Indian history where foreigners assimilated into Indian society on such a large scale as they were in the post-modern time. So this is the time when the maximum number of foreigners were considered Indianized. Okay, the post-modern times. Religion. Some of the foreign rulers were converted to Vaishnavism, which means the worship of Vishnu, the god of protection and preservation. Now, the Greek ambassador called Heliodorus set up a pillar. Okay, this is the pillar with the picture you see. So, Greek ambassador, he set up a pillar and this is in the honor of Vishnu. Okay, you should know that. Honor of Vishnu near Vidisha, that is in Madhya Pradesh. A few other rulers adopted Buddhism. The famous Greek ruler, Menander, was converted to Buddhism. The questions and answers, Nagasena, we already saw that Milinda Pannu. Okay, cultural history is explained and all those things. The Kushan rulers worship both Shiva and the Buddha, and the images of these two gods appeared on the Kushan coins. Several Kushan rulers were worshippers of Vishnu. This is certainly the case with the Kushan ruler Vasudeva. If you see the name, Vasudeva means Krishna only. So that means they worshipped Buddhism, Shiva and Vishnu, all the three. Okay. Now, origin of the Mahayana Buddhism. The contact with the foreigners brought about changes in the Indian religion. This especially happened to Buddhism. Buddhism in its original form was too Puritanical, or it's like it's more complicated for foreigners, okay, to understand. So that is why they wanted some simpler form or a more elaborate form, you can tell. Okay, that is why Mahayana Buddhism will come. They developed a new form of Buddhism called the Mahayana or the Greater Wheel, and whatever, and here also image of the Buddha was worshipped. Okay, in Mahayana Buddhism, image of the Buddha was worshipped. The doors of this sect was open to all sections. Those who did not subscribe to the newly founded sect came to be known as the followers of the Hinayana or the smaller wheel. Okay, so the earlier one, which is the actual Buddha teaching, is Hinayana or smaller wheel, and the new one is Mahayana Buddhism. Fortunately for Mahayana, Kanishka became its great patron. He convened a council in Kashmir where the Buddhist teachings were engraved on sheets of copper and deposited under a stupa. We do not know the contents of their inscriptions because the stupa has not been discovered so far. Kanishka set up many stupas in memory of the Buddha. So you should know Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, everything is related to Kanishka. And Kanishka's court poet is Ashwaghosha also. You should know that. Okay, Ashwaghosha, who wrote Buddha Charita. That is a different aspect, but you should know. Gandhara art. The foreign princes have enthusiastically patronized Indian art and literature, and they showed the zeal characteristic of new converts. The Kushan Empire brought together masons and other artisans trained in different schools and countries. Indian craftsmen came into contact with the Greeks and the Romans, especially in the northwestern frontier of India, in Gandhara. This gave rise to new kind of art. So just the art form Gandhara, I have already told you multiple times, Gandhara, Mathura art form. This is one picture of that. Okay, image of Buddha, Gandhara. In which images of the Buddha were made in the Greco-Roman style. The hair of the Buddha was fashioned in a Greco-Roman style. The influence of the Gandhara art also spread to Mathura, although it was primarily a center of indigenous art. So Indianized version is in Mathura and Greek version is in Gandhara. Mathura produced beautiful images of the Buddha, but it is also famous for the headless erect statue of Kanishka, whose name is inscribed on its lower part. So this again becomes important. Okay. Mathura produced beautiful image of Buddha, but is famous for headless erect statue of Kanishka. Okay, Kanishka statue is there, which is headless, but name is written at the bottom. That is there in Mathura. Don't get confused. People will think it is in Gandhara, but it is in Mathura. Okay, it also produced several stone images of Vardhamana Mahavira. Okay, so now Jainism is also coming into picture. So the Mathura school of art flourished in the early centuries of the Christian era, and its products made of red sandstone are found even outside Mathura. Okay, at present, the Mathura Museum possesses the largest collection of sculptures of Kushana times. Okay, so Mathura is having the largest number of sculptures. and also the headless Kanishka is also there. During the same period, we notice beautiful works of art at several places south of the Vindhyas. Beautiful Buddhist caves were constructed out of rocks in Maharashtra. In Andhra Pradesh, Nagarjunakonda and Amaravati, it became great centers of Buddhist art, and the stories connected with Buddha came to be portrayed in numerous panels. The earliest panels dealing with Buddhism are found at Gaya, Sanchi and Barut and belong to the 2nd century BC. But we notice further development in sculpture in the early centuries of the Christian era. So it's telling the same thing, okay, the culture, history, Buddhism, these things keep on developing at that time. Sanchi Stupa, again, you should know it's very important. One of the Indian new currency has this thing in one of the side, okay, the back side has Sanchi Stupa. Tell me in the comment section which note it has. Okay, now literature and learning. The foreign princes patronized and cultivated Sanskrit literature. The early specimen of Kavya style is found in the inscription of Rudra Daman in Kathiyavar in about AD 150. From now onwards, inscriptions began to be composed in chaste Sanskrit, although the use of Prakrit in composing inscriptions continued till the 4th century AD. So even though Prakrit was still there, Sanskrit was getting popularized. It seems that some of the great creative writers such as Ashwagosha enjoyed the patronage of Kushans. Ashwagosha wrote the Buddha Charita, which is the biography of Buddha. He also composed Saundarananda. Okay, UPSC will pick up this thing. Okay, everyone will study Buddha Charita and go, and UPSC will ask a question on Saundarananda. So you know, it is also written by Ashwagosha, who is the writer in the court of Kanishka. The progress of Mahayana Buddhism led to the composition of numerous avadanas. Okay, most of these texts were composed in what is known as the Buddhist hybrid Sanskrit. Their one objective was to preach teachings of Mahayana Buddhism to the people. Some of the important books of this genre was Mahavastu and Divyavadana. Okay, you should know this also. Divya Prabandhanam is something related to this thing, okay, Vishnu. But this is Divya Vadana, that is related to Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, Divya Vadana and Mahavastu. The foreigners also contributed to the development of Indian theatre by introducing the use of curtain. Okay, theatre and curtain, you know. So that was actually Greeks' contribution, and that is why it is called Yavanika. Okay, why Yavanika? Because these Greeks were called as Yavana. Yavana is actually a Sanskritized form of Ionian. Ionian is a branch of Greeks. Okay, so see the connection. Greek is called Ionian. Ionian is pronounced as Yavana in Sanskrit, and in Yavana it became Yavanika. The curtain is called Yavanika. Okay, see that thing. We'll see similar names, okay, later. Yavana Priya will come in, I think, next chapter. That is another term. The Yavanika is the curtain used in Indian theatre and is derived from the Ionian name of Greek. And later this Yavana will become applied to all the foreigners. Okay, initially, even though it was just Greeks, later it is like Yavana is used for everyone. Indian astronomy and astrology profited from the contacts with the Greeks. Okay, we notice many Greek terms about the movement of planets in Sanskrit text. This Indian astrology came to be influenced by the Greek ideas and from the Greek term horoscope. Greek term horoscope was derived from the term Horoshastra, used for astrology in Sanskrit. So see the connection, horoscope and Horoshastra. However, the Indians did not owe anything striking to the Greeks in medicine, botany and chemistry. So medicine, botany and chemistry, there is no dependency on Greek. Okay, Indians had their own people, their own talented people like Charaka and Sushruta. Okay, Sushruta. The Charaka Samhita contains names of numerous plants and herbs from which drugs are to be prepared for the use of patients. The processes laid down for the pounding and mixing of the plants give us the idea of the developed knowledge of chemistry in ancient India. Okay, so Indians themselves had lot of knowledge about the plants and mixing of plants to make drugs. For the cure of ailments, the ancient Indian physician relied chiefly on plants, for which the Sanskrit word is Aushadhi. Okay, the plants is called Aushadhi, and that is why medicine is called Aushadhi. Okay, you should know these kind of derivations. In the field of technology also, the Indians seem to have profited from contract with the Central Asians. Kanishka is represented as wearing trousers and long boots. Okay, possibly the practice of making leather shoes began in India during this period. In any case, the Kushan copper coins in India were imitations of the Roman coins. We have seen this already. Similarly, gold coins in India were struck by Kushans in imitation of Roman gold coins. We hear of two embassies being exchanged between the Indian kings and the Roman kings. Embassies were sent from India to the court of the Roman Emperor Augustus. Okay, so embassies were sending. Embassies exchange was happening between India and Rome in AD 27-28 and also to the Roman Empire Trajan in AD 110-20. Okay, thus the contacts of Rome with ancient India may have introduced new practices in technology. Working in glass during this period was essentially influenced by foreign ideas and practices. In no other period in India did glass making make such progress. So if you see, foreigners also too much in this time period, and glass making and leather making, all these things also too much, coins also, and embassy exchange. So these kind of things you should know. When suddenly UPSC frames a question like which of the following is true with regard to post-Mauryan times, then you should know this is the post-Mauryan time. Okay, all these foreigners coming into India and settling, that is the post-Mauryan time. So you should know all these happenings. Okay, some questions are there. If you want, you can pause and see, but I'll show you the MCQs as usual, okay, which we have to actually practice, and it's picked up from the PDF. Which are the following are true regarding Rudra Daman 1? He was the strongest Rashtrakuta ruler. He wrote the first ever longest inscriptions in Sanskrit in those days. He was known for the repair works in Lake Sudarshana in semi-arid region of Kathiawar. He was a foreigner settled in India. Okay, tell me whether everything is true or anything is false. Okay, now because after the lecture it will sound very easy, but UPSC will trouble you with such questions in the actual exam. Two more questions, very simple questions. Ancient Sanskrit text mentions Saka Pahalavas. So whom does Pahalavas refer to? This is directly picked up from this, so please try to answer. Next one, which one of the central Asian powers which entered India belonged to the Yechus tribe? Okay, this also I covered in this lecture, so tell me which one. Okay, which one is the branch of Yechus tribe? Okay, so this is how UPSC asks you very straightforward direct question from the textbook, but you just need to cover the textbook. Okay, I know it is very boring to read the ancient history textbook and all, that is why I'm making this video just for free. Okay, every lecture is free, 27 chapters I'll be uploading from this textbook, so please try to get the MCQs at least. Okay, so we need some income to just sustain this channel, so we are requesting you to get the MCQs, which you can see like this. It's like directly picked up from the textbook, so you will not miss even one thing from any textbook, okay, any standard textbook. So try to speed up your preparation. See the link in the description box below. Till I come with the next video, thank you and enjoy your learning.